Welcome. In this video, we are going to start our discussion on testing of hypothesis. So I would like to have a brief introduction about the testing of hypothesis. So I hope in this video, we will cover only the basics, the very fundamental basics. Okay. Suppose our interest centers on a random variable X. Okay. That has a density function f of X comma theta. Hopefully we understand that this theta is the unknown parameter which we estimate through the MLE and point estimation or the interval estimation of this theta has to be found. Okay, and this theta is taken from the suitable space omega. Suppose that this theta belong to W naught or this theta belong to W1, where when you make the union of these two things, you get this whole set omega, and these sets are disjoint. So basically this omega, the big omega, is the set of all possible values that the theta can take. Okay, that set is divided into two disjoint sets, and we have the case that this theta belong to this small omega naught or theta belong to this omega 1. So only either of this will be true. Okay, we are going to label this hypothesis as H naught, that is theta is in W naught, versus H1, where theta is in omega 1. Okay, so small omega naught and small omega 1. Okay, these hypothesis, this H naught, is referred to as null hypothesis. And this H1 is referred to as alternate hypothesis. Often the null hypothesis represents no change or no different from the past, while the alternate represents change or difference. This alternate is often referred to as the research worker's hypothesis. So basically, you are having something, let's say some murder, some crime happened. Okay, so we suspect someone. Okay, the null hypothesis would be the suspect is not guilty. Okay, so because to prove not guilty, you don't have to produce anything. Okay, unless and until you prove that person has done something, he is not guilty. Okay, so the alternate hypothesis would be he is guilty. So in order to prove guilty, you will have to do some base work, and you will have to produce some evidence to prove him guilty. Okay, generally, okay, so this is some outset idea with which you can understand the null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. Null hypothesis is the one that happens naturally. Okay, we don't have to really perform some calculation or do some research to prove null hypothesis. Okay, whereas to prove alternate hypothesis, we will have to perform some calculations. So basically, we do some calculations and see whether we are accepting alternate hypothesis or not. Okay, but when we work with problems, we say whether we reject null hypothesis or accept null hypothesis. So when we reject null hypothesis, of course we need to accept the alternate hypothesis. Okay, and moving further, we have simple and composite hypothesis. First, let me explain about the simple one. It refers to the one in which all parameters associated with the distribution are stated. Okay, so all parameters associated with the distribution are stated. Okay, so for instance, if the height of the students in a school is distributed normally with variance 6, and the hypothesis that the mean stands equivalent to 70. So our hypothesis is mean is 70. Okay, this is the hypothesis. So when this is the hypothesis, of course, what would be our H1? Mean is not 70. Okay. Sometimes we may need mu is bigger than 70 or mu is smaller than 70. That may be the case. As of now, what we are stating is that this is the null hypothesis that mu is 70. Okay. If you look at the statement, this stands to be simple hypothesis as the variance and the mean both completely follow normal distribution. Okay. Here, the population is following normal distribution and the values are very well known to us. So, in this case, it is a simple hypothesis. Okay. The next one is the composite hypothesis. It refers to the hypothesis that does not stand simple. For instance, if you assume your mu na, H naught is mu bigger than 70 and sigma square smaller than 6, or it may be the other way around, H naught is mu equals 70 and sigma square is smaller than 6. In these hypotheses, they become a composite hypothesis, because in either of the cases, the exact distribution is not known. So, exact distribution is not known. So, basically, a simple hypothesis is the one in which the parameters associated with the distribution are completely known or completely stated. Whereas in the composite hypothesis, exact distribution is not known. Okay. So, now that we have seen what do we mean by simple and composite hypothesis, now let us try to see the differences between, main differences between these two set of hypotheses. So, a composite, as specified in the definition, type of the distribution is not known in, is not completely known in composite hypothesis, whereas it is completely known in simple hypothesis. Okay, the second one is, when a simple null hypothesis is required to be tested in consultation with the composite alternative, that is like this case, mu is 70 and sigma square is 6. Okay, but still we have some missing information about the distribution. Okay, the power associated with the test tend to be function pertaining to the parameter of interest. So in this case, what happened is that here, if we are looking for this mu, okay, we are going to test whether mu is 70 to certain level of acceptance or it is not. So if this is the case, that variable, the power associated with this mu is the parameter of interest. Okay, and moving further, variation in power can be experienced due to the size of the sample. Okay, so let me let's move these are the things that we have discussed. What do we mean by a hypothesis? How do we test the hypothesis? What do we mean by null and alternate hypothesis? Simple and composite, that also we have seen. And there are two type of errors. This alpha is the probability of type 1 error. That is the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is true. And the type 2 error is probability of accepting null hypothesis when it is false. Okay. So, the following table gives us the error. Okay. When H0 is true, And when we accept it, there is no error. So it's perfect. When H naught is false and when we reject H naught, in that case also it is fine. Okay. So H naught is basically true. But we reject it. So in that case, what we get is the type 1 error, and that is what we denote it as alpha. Okay. And when H naught is false, but based on the calculation that we have done, we are accepting it. So in that case, we have an error that is beta. So basically, in any statistical calculation, we try to minimize both alpha and beta. Okay, we try to make sure that our calculation is getting better and better. Okay, and moving further, so the significance level of test is usually the probability of type 1 error alpha. Okay, and when you try to plot this as either standard normal curve or t-distribution curve, you find some region. So that is the region of rejection, and that is what we call it as critical region, and the remaining part would be the acceptance region. Okay, and this 1 minus beta is taken as the power of a test. Okay, now that we are ready to start doing problems on testing of hypothesis, and that shall be covered in the next video. Thank you.